Welcome, everyone, to Seeds of Liberty podcast, episode 30. We're going to go with Jeremy for the BIPCOT no-gov license.
Oh, the string is broken. yes, the Seeds of Liberty podcast is covered by the BIPCOT no-gov license. This allows for reuse by anyone except for governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about this at BIPCOT.org.
So today we have Jon Moss returning for another edition about unschooling and government school.
Our first return guest. Congratulations. Somebody actually wanted to put up with us a second time. All right.
we had a lot of people message us because of that episode. I guess when you put unschooling or homeschooling and stuff in titles, more people hear it than what we expect in our little echo chamber, and it is very refreshing to hear people say, "Wow!" We had Amanda on a few weeks ago, and she heard that episode, and it's drastically changed her life.
Wow, that's good to hear.
Yes, yeah, one of our one of our higher listen to episodes, I think. Amanda wasn't even actually a voluntaryist when she listened to the episode.
Yeah, that's the cool thing with homeschooling is that it really runs the gauntlet of everybody. I mean, conservatives homeschool, libertarians homeschool, liberals homeschool. I mean, it appeals more to some groups than others, but you really do get everybody in homeschooling. So yeah, it can attract a lot of people, sure.
Yeah, let me just finish up for people who haven't heard Jon Moss and didn't catch him the first time.
Go back and listen to it.
He's a voluntarist, peaceful parenter, and unschooler of a 7-year-old, and he runs the New Sons and Daughters of Liberty Facebook page, and he's also an admin on Raising Common Sense Anarchists. So he's a great source of information for unschooling, and you know, I love spreading the word, on my own channel as well about unschoolers, because so many, I have a 5-year-old and a 3-year-old, and we definitely are planning on, mixture of homeschooling and unschooling, probably closer to unschooling, but, I meet up with a lot of people, and they always ask me questions like, you know, what is a typical day? Are you the only one? and it's funny because, we know we're not the only one, but it's nice to have a resource where I can give them, here's interviews I've done of people who are actually doing it, and there's many different ways to do it. And I find that people, and I've already had one woman that I've met that said that I've, through the videos I've sent her, the interviews, that I've inspired her to homeschool her kids, which is pretty...
That's great to hear.
Pretty awesome. Go ahead.
Yeah, that's great to hear. I do have to say that you can learn a whole lot more about unschooling just talking to other people who do it.
Yeah.
I'll be very honest. I've never read a single book on homeschooling, on peaceful parenting. I've hardly read a lot of books on voluntarism, things like that. I get most of my knowledge from discussing ideas with people. I get so much more out of hopping into a community with tons of like-minded individuals, but who can each have their own take on something. You follow?
Yeah.
And from listening to the Seeds of Liberty podcast, right? Trademark pending, right?
And that too, true. podcasts, things like that. So if you're interested, the best advice I can give to start out with is find a Facebook group or a Reddit group or an internet group of whatever, and just start talking to other people who are doing it. Yeah, I figured it was a good time to bring this topic up. I also co-host on the Currency of Anarchy, and we just did a back to unschool edition because it's September, it's that time of year, and so figure now's the time. People are interested in it, and there's also the parents who have had their kids in school for like a month now and maybe are starting to get frustrated with it again and want to do something, but they just don't know what to do. Pull them out. Pull your kids out of these prisons.
There was a huge, I guess I stoked a fire the other day on Facebook and got about 1,000 comment thread about circumcision. And someone was like, you got to do things for your kids that they're not going to like, you got to send them to school. You got to, you know, you got to bathe them, you got to do this, you got to, I'm like, sending a child to school is probably one of the worst things you can do for that child.
That is the quickest way to destroy your child's creativity and desire to learn. To send them into a prison where they have to obey an authority figure all day. Their entire day is centered around a bell, like they're Pavlov's dog. Like they're in math class and maybe they're interested and they're learning about geometry or shapes or whatever. And the child is really interested. And then ding, 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 ding. Stop thinking about geometry. Start thinking about science for the next 45 minutes or however long that lasts. Yeah. And what if they don't give a shit about science? And now you're taking them away from something they were really enjoying and forcing them to spend the rest of the day not thinking about what they were really interested in, which is why unschooling is a fantastic idea, because if your child is going with something, give it to them and let them run with it. Let them take it as far as they want to. Don't tell them to stop. That's one of the worst ways you can stifle creativity in your child.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's funny. I mean, yeah, of course, if they enjoy one thing and you take it away from it, that's one thing. But even if you have a kid who enjoys learning and gets something positive out of every class, mm-hmm. even them, it's still, you know, stop and go, stop and stop and go, stop and go. And then people like wonder completely unironically why most people have ridiculously short attention spans. Mm-hmm. And are swayed by, yeah, exactly, Dave.
My life's not regimented enough. I didn't pay enough attention in school.
ADD challenged friend over there.
I'm accepting disability checks soon for my ADD.
Yes. But that's the world we live in, and people like actually wonder aloud why that is, because they think, oh, I have a pretty good attention span. Why all these? Why do you think? You're brought up to bounce from subject to subject and thing to thing to thing and not keep a focus on anything for longer than 45 minutes. Or I think even, geez, back when I was in school, I think when they first extended, like tried to shove an extra period in there, they cut the classes down to like 38 minutes or something like that.
Even and, if you're interested, what are you going to learn in 38 minutes?
Yeah, and it's even less because by the time you get in and the bell rings and the teacher finally starts talking and goes through, like you actually, you know, if what you may actually learn is probably, you know, 25 minutes top. So
you were on the thing where they were doing 7 periods a semester. Was that what it was? Because something happened.
Nine.
My freshman year in high school, I had seven periods a semester. And then, like, my sophomore year, it changed to where we have 4. So it was really weird. Like, classes were, like, an hour and a half long.
No, we never. So. In PA and in New York, where I went to school, we never had that in either place. It was always 7 to 9 periods, with one of them being a lunch and sometimes one of them being a study hall. But other than that, it was, you know, the full day and just cram one after the other, and you just bounce from. And I was like, you know, we've discussed it before. I was somebody who's pretty good in school, because I, you know, I was able to memorize things and
obey.
Not really. Yeah, exactly. I was a good little status student, and I fell into the Prussian system quite well, and I did well, and I enjoyed most subjects. But you know, of course, I didn't think of it at the time. But yeah, it's just from one thing to another, and that's all it ever is. And then you grow up, and you know, like I said, people wonder why everybody is jumping from one subject to the next and can't. You know, it's by design. I feel so.
Absolutely, you're absolutely trained into it.
Yeah. It's part of the process.
Follow the order. Government schools, and let's call them that, government schools. Let's stop calling them public schools.
I always do. Yeah.
They are government schools.
Yeah.
Government schools don't give a shit about your kids at all. Their job right there is to crank out workers, taxpayers, and soldiers. That is all they want. They want to crank those out as quickly and efficiently as they can. And the best thing you can do, what can I do to stop it, is just stop playing along. Stop it. Just, I changed my hours at work. I work at a casino. I work now overnight, 8 p.m. to 4 a.m., just so I can be home during the day with my daughter to homeschool. The decision was that important for us.
Yeah, the I remember listening to a Stefan Molyneux podcast, and he was saying three ways that the state makes or creates dependent citizens is the first thing they have to do is break up the husband-wife relationship, and then break up the parent-child relationship, and then make sure you herd all the kids to government school to so that they understand, you know, government history, government economics, which is basically government economics is all, you know, the science of understanding, you know, monetary policy, foreign policy, right? Every yeah. law, that's what economics is in the Keynesian sense.
And it's what they want you to know. They're not teaching you anything. They're basically telling you regurgitate this information or else you fail.
Yeah.
You know, what's that quote about judging a fish by its ability to ride a bicycle or something like that? It's public school to a T, that quote. It's absolutely perfect.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, so I, you know, I tell the people that I hang out with, a lot of homeschooling mothers, and I tell them, you know, just by you,
he has to throw that in every time. It's not just I hang out with other homeschoolers. It's like hang out with a lot of hot homeschooling moms.
Well, I didn't say hot. I just said homeschooling moms.
Hot and bothered homeschooling moms.
Their husbands are out at work, you know.
Oh, and Danilo swoops in. What a dastardly soul-patched mother lover.
This is how you know that Danilo's wife never listens to our show. Because it's one thing for us to needle him, but he jumps in right away with no hesitation.
No.
And yes. So you know it's funny, a lot of them they tell me you know about how they you know register their kids as homeschoolers by the state, you know, so that CPS doesn't come after them. And I say, you know, the first and foremost, like if you were to listen to what Carlos Morales says about why people call, you know, like call CPS on other people. And one of the primary reasons is homeschooling, regardless is if you are, you know, complying by the book, by the regulation, you are a registered homeschooler. You know, it's still possible for your kid to be taken away and removed for the purpose of homeschooling. You know, homeschooling itself is an act of, you know, being anti-state, you know, and you're considered an extremist and you're a danger. You're an enemy of the state, you know, just
absolutely.
By you.
Absolutely. It freaks people out on almost a reefer madness type level. people hear homeschoolers and they immediately think that I'm this like, you know, super religious Mormon weirdo who has a sheltered child who doesn't do anything but like, you know, sit in her room and read scripture all day. It's like, you're not even close, not even in the ballpark of what it is we do.
They assume things of what they don't understand because
they've
been told by the media, by the government itself, that you know homeschooling has always been frowned upon because, for obvious reasons why it is, but it's always, you know, it's been marginalized and it's been singled out. And yes, it started out as a highly religious movement originally. Most even back as far as like, you know, the Amish not wanting to have anything to do with it, like everybody who didn't want to have anything to do with public schools, as they were, or government schools, as we like to call them, it was a religious that, you know, different religions, and they wanted to teach their children things, and for most people, they still think that's the same thing. They haven't bothered to investigate it any further, so they remember being told that, and it's just like, oh, you must be a religious nut, of course. Although, I mean, I am encouraged. I mean, Dave's thrown out numbers a couple of times during a couple episodes about the increase over the last, 10 years or so?
70%
or maybe
increase.
Yeah, or maybe 20 years, which it was extremely small to start. So 70% is not that big in terms of what it was. But it's the trend is still going upward. And I was very encouraged by an article. I think my wife actually posted it. Might have been something as affluent as like Beverly Hills or somewhere like that. There was a story coming out about a lot of parents in areas like that are now going toward, like not like the the actual actors that already homeschool or have, you know, tutors on set or whatever, but like just the quote unquote normal rich people are starting to drift more and more towards homeschools over private schooling. I think it was in one of the big Baltimore papers and in one of the, it might've been the Times. I'm not sure. I don't remember where I read the actual article from, but just to read that, I was like, wow, this is a, you know, that's encouraging to finally see people of that status, I guess that you want to say, mm-hmm. and making major, you know, mainstream-ish type news. Like that's a big deal. That's got to be encouraging for, you know, somebody like yourself who's involved in this now. I mean, we've discussed before. I'm going to be involved in it. My kids are only 4, so I still have another year or so before I'm really going to get moving in any direction. Although, I hope I'm out of New York by the time that happens. That's my plan, because I don't want to have to, you know, what Danilo was saying with the registration and all that. Like, I don't want to have to deal with that. I avoid a lot of other things myself personally, but I don't want to have to deal with that mess. Because the one agency that does scare me is CPS.
I'm not have my children stolen from me. Are you serious? That's a terrifying thought. Maybe there's some people who shouldn't have kids and who, you know, lay around and do drugs all day or whatever. I mean, you know, whatever the case may be, neglect or whatever. But they don't discriminate, the CPS. They just, I mean, they hear something and they say, okay, let's go get them. And they come in with the cavalry and,
they have quotas, John.
It's unbelievable. What's that?
They have quotas.
Yeah, and you know, to fill those quotas, they're taking children away from decent families who love their kids, and they're putting their kids in these foster homes where they just don't belong. All in all, it's a shitty situation and an even shittier bureaucracy that goes along with it.
So I have a pragmatic question to ask you. Do you think that the homeschooling crowd, once it becomes big enough, should state by state, like, try to force some kind of tax-exempt status? Like, hey, my kid's not going to this public school. I don't want to pay for it. You know what I'm saying? Like, should that be something that libertarians and homeschoolers kind of play into? And, you know, and I say this on a pragmatic thing because, you know, if we're going moral here, I mean, no libertarian should ever vote, but on a pragmatic thing, as a self-defense, if you could get rid of your property tax is what pays for the school. If you could get rid of your property tax, if that exemption happens, that's going to push more people into homeschooling, and the government schools are going to go bankrupt.
Yeah, I'm a voluntarist. I don't think anyone should be paying any kind of taxes at all. But let's be realistic. We live in a world where we're paying taxes, and you know, they send men with guns after you if you don't pay these taxes. If a town could get together and have some kind of referendum or a vote and say, hey, listen, you know, this is largely a homeschooling community. You don't need these property taxes. I would love to see government officials defend why they would still need those taxes in that situation.
What kind of percentage do you think would have to put? I'm thinking like 30. Like, here's the problem. They could always ship in more immigrants to a school, right? Let's say legitimately 30, 40% of the people pull their kids out of the public school. Like, any business loses 40 or 30% of their clientele. They're going to go belly up. I mean, that's.
Oh, I see.
But the government is not a business, though.
I know the government isn't a business.
It's a shitty one.
Businesses. Sure. Businesses can't put a gun in your face and tell you to buy. They go bankrupt.
Right.
I mean, I guess they would just probably print more money. I mean, that's what they do with everything. You know, I don't know what to do. Okay, let's print more money and throw some more money at it.
The federal government doesn't have a property tax on you. I mean, they have eminent domain, but they don't have a property tax. The property taxes come from the states. So the state is also in charge of their own Department of Education for each state. So I think that would have to be some kind of deal that homeschoolers would have to, like, a homeschooling tax exemption to me makes a lot of pragmatic sense. I mean, if you want your kid to go to a public school, you should pay for it. If you don't, forcing someone else to pay for that doesn't make much sense. Even if you're not a libertarian or an anarchist or whatever, even when you hear that laid out that simply, forcing someone else to pay for your child's education is morally bankrupt. And that should be a very simple even on both sides of this issue, that should be a very simple, hey, that person's child is not going to this school. That person is not going to have any children. Like me, I don't have children. I'm paying for schools. Like, why should I have to? I should be exempt. Unless you have kids in the school, you should be exempt. And, you know, people are going to say, oh, well, there's poor people. How are they going to get educated? That's not my problem. I didn't have those kids. Start a charity.
You don't understand, Dave. You just have to pay your fair share. All right, stop bitching.
Well, come on, Dave. You don't want to have a bunch of stupid people around you, do you?
Oh yeah, yeah.
That's one of the more, I guess, famous memes for in like anti homeschool.
John Green.
Yeah, exactly. Where he says, I don't, you know, it's something to that effect where I don't want to be surrounded by stupid people. I'm happy to pay my taxes because
I don't want to be surrounded by stupid people. He's surrounded by people who don't know how the Fed works, how economics work. They can tell you all about the Pythagorean theorem, though. They learned that in school.
They can tell you all what Kim Kardashian tweeted last week, but.
Well, that fits into the short attention span thing that I was talking about earlier, but go ahead.
I was going to say U.S. public schools. I mean, they're not even cracking the top 10 anymore in math and science. I mean, these are the places you're sending your kids to go to school. They're not teaching them anything. The literacy rates are sliding. My daughter was miles ahead of her class in reading in kindergarten, and they just flat refused to push her along. So your kids aren't learning anything. You got to get them out.
Yeah, absolutely.
I got a quick point, and I don't know if you've ever heard this, John. What public schools, what city public schools spends the most per student in the country?
What city's public school?
Yes.
If I had to guess, it would probably be something like Chicago, New York.
I was just going to say Chicago.
No, it's Baltimore. They pay almost $19,000 a year for each student, and their school system is completely bankrupt. Mm-hmm. They can't pay for this. They're borrowing money. That's why Baltimore's going bankrupt. For their schools and their police unions and all their other unions they have. But here's the thing. If all those people in Baltimore that are paying all these taxes, which they're not, these are federal loans for the city of Baltimore. But let's play like it, what would be really happening. Do you think that $18,000, you could not personally with $18,000, just if the city of Baltimore said, here, Ms. Johnson, here's $18,000 to educate your child however you see fit. Do you think there will be smarter kids coming out of Baltimore or dumber kids?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, depends on the person, but yeah.
Well, it depends as a diaper.
Statistically, yes, of course. I could probably educate my entire neighborhood for $18,000-$19,000 a year.
Absolutely. I mean, you know how much I spend a year on educating my daughter? Essentially nothing. I mean, we have an internet connection, but if she went to public school, we'd have that anyway. So as far as I'm concerned, that's not really a homeschool cost for me. Maybe it is for some parents, and if that's the case, it's worth it. You've got to get your kids on the internet. I mean, Google and YouTube, I mean, there's just, they can find any information they want on the internet, and you don't need to send your kids to public education. You can educate at home for free. What else do I spend money on? I don't know, the occasional museum ticket. We'll go to the museum. I don't know, most parks are free. You can take nature walks whenever we want. You know, learning is not meant to be limited to a classroom. When you unschool, everything is a lesson. I cook a lot at home, and my daughter helps me with that. She's learning fractions and not even realize.
Right, exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I wouldn't even call what happens in government school learning either, because to me, learning is something that happens voluntarily when you're interested in something, right? When you're not interested and you're forced to memorize it and then regurgitate it, to me, that's more like indoctrination. So
And the kids are being indoctrinated too. I mean, my daughter used to have lockdown drills at her school to simulate like a live shooter in the school. They're trying to condition these kids to police state and all that stuff. It's just terrible.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's, yeah, you're right. There's really no way that the state can continue to function with obedient citizens without a very enhanced and, you know, colossal government school system to keep them in place, you know, keep them down so they know their inferiority. Go ahead.
Yeah, when they're in school, it's like, here's what to learn. This is true. This is what you're going to learn. Repeat after me. Mm-hmm. When you bring them home and homeschool, it's, Daddy, what's this? Okay, well, it's the other thing. Okay, yeah. Well, why? How does it work? Why? Yeah. Why does it do this? Why is this? Why is it? Why? Yeah. And you encourage that, and they don't encourage that in public school. Like, what do you mean, why? Because this is it. This is the way it is. This is the way I told you. This is, you know, I'm the teacher. and you know, when you say shit like that, the kids just tune it right out. They don't want to hear that.
Yeah.
So what do you do? If you're listening to this podcast and you're like, okay, well, you guys are talking a big game. What do I do? I'm ready to unschool my child. What do I do? First thing you got to do is check your local state laws, because homeschooling does vary state by state. And I know we're anarchists and don't give a shit about the state and the rules and all that. But as we discussed, CPS is a pretty dangerous organization. And I don't mind messing with bureaucrats, but bureaucrats that can steal my child from me, I'm not going to mess with too much. Here in Connecticut, all I had to do was write a letter to the superintendent saying, okay, I'm withdrawing my daughter and we'll be homeschooling in accordance with statute XYZ, whatever it was. And that's that, signed my name and my wife's name. And that was it. And we were on our own. We didn't have to go in for evaluations or testing. We didn't have to tell them what we were teaching. It was just pull your kids and boom, you're on your own. You're good to go. That's not the case in every state. Shockingly, shockingly, Connecticut is one of the best states to homeschool. And as psychotically liberal and big government as they are one of the best homeschool states.
Is that the only positive about Connecticut, from what I recall, as far as laws go?
Technically, you can open or conceal carry in Connecticut. Over in Rhode Island, you can't carry at all. Carry here in Connecticut. I don't because the state's full of psychotic liberals who will, you know, shout at me in the supermarket for having a gun. So I don't open carry. But
I don't have that problem down here, John. If people don't see you without a gun, they go, what's that guy up to? He doesn't have a gun.
What state are you in?
I'm in Alabama.
Oh shit, they practically hand them out in Happy Meals down there.
No, it's not that bad.
Well, yeah, I was going to say, you know, as far as how to get started, yeah, I mean, I agree, obviously. I mean, because I'm here in New York where the laws are quite stringent.
You don't and, say.
That's why I want to get the heck out of here so I don't have to deal with them. But, yes, of course.
Channel your inner Kurt Russell, man.
Thank you.
You guys have crazy gun laws, too. Like, you're only allowed, slingshots and muzzle loaders and shit like that.
Yeah, it's yeah. Oh, come on. They got rid of the ridiculous 7 rounds. They had no choice because after Prince Andrew did it, within a couple of months they realized that nobody makes 7 round magazines, and they had to backtrack. And first they said, well, you can have a 10 round, but you can only have 7 in it. And then when everybody said that's ridiculous, they finally had to capitulate and said, okay, fine, you can have your 10 rounds back. But all the laws here are horrible. But yeah, obviously the first thing is to check your laws. I would encourage people that if they're pursuing this avenue to, if you have to, consider moving. Because that's, you know, like I said, that's what I'm going to do. Because the other thing, at least for me, I think one of the biggest concerns and or flat out rejections I get when this topic comes up, and you know, I try to bring it to other people, is, oh well, you know, we can't afford that because, you know, somebody has to stay home with the kids. Well, you should really look into your finances and look into what exactly you're spending money on, because most people who don't think they can homeschool because both parents work currently, assume that, well, both of us work because we have to work. Well, that may be true to some extent, but how much money are both of you spending on travel to and from work? How much are both of you spending on wardrobe and or uniforms, you know, for work? How much money, you know, how much money are you spending, you know, if you don't bring your lunch, you know, if you have to buy lunch when you're at, like, all these things. How much money do you and your partner both spend at work, just to make the money? How much money are you laying out in order to get that? And a lot of people, once they start crunching those numbers, you realize, well, wait a minute, if I don't have to spend all this stuff, even if we have to go down to now one car, or, you know, whatever it is, like all these expenses that most people just take for granted, well, if you just get rid of some of these things that you don't need because one of you stays home, well then, it makes it a lot more affordable. Which actually, I just wanted to, just to go back to something Dave was saying earlier about the tax situation and what it would take for some kind of rebate or the credit or whatever it is. I would say that if you got that percentage of people, if you had 30-40% of the people, you just flat out to stick with the anarchist motto, just flat out refuse to pay it. Just say, we're not going to pay this anymore, you know, like, because that's all it would take. If you get that kind of numbers, I've said this repeatedly about any of the taxes. If you get those kind of numbers in any one area that just flat out refuse to, like, the quickest way to destroy any law is to make it unenforceable. And how do you do that? By people just not. Dude, we outnumber the state agents in every situation, in every capacity, in every area.
Can I play devil's advocate here for a second?
Well, just hold on. I all I'm saying is, if you got, because you're saying, you know, if people got together and played the state card for, you know, pragmatic reasons, I would posit that you don't even have to. But that's another thing. Whether you just opt out of paying or you try to get the people in your town organized to say, hey, let's go to the town, let's go to the city, let's go to the state, whatever it is, and say, we want to, you know, credit or whatever, whichever route you take, that's even more money now. And a lot of people, like, they don't, like, they just assume they can't afford it. But if you knock out all those other bills and then you knock out that tax some way or somehow, how can you honestly use that as an excuse anymore? Because I think just those two things alone will show you the people that, for better or worse, actually really care about their kids and really
You got to weigh the options, and you got to say, how important is this to my family that I homeschool and get my kids out of here? Weigh how important it is. Yeah. Move if you have to. Cut your expenses if you have to. Like I said, I changed my hours to overnight to do this. I understand, you know, not everybody can do things like that, but, you know, if where there's a will, there's a way. I hate to use stupid cliches like that, but it's so true. If you really want to do this, you can do this. Maybe in a few minutes we can get to dispelling a couple of myths that I hear about homeschooling.
Should I start an unschooling co-op? Hey, yeah, just drop your kids off and some food, and I'll make sure they don't get shot or kill each other.
Yeah, I mean, why not?
No, but the whole thing I was going to say to Jeremy's point is I'm not too sure on this. How do sheriffs get paid? Like, what from what taxes do they get paid on average? Is it's not property taxes?
I guess it depends, because I'm actually in one of the worst places to ask that question, because Nassau County has, I think, the only unelected sheriff in the entire country. If there's there may be one other one, but
that's
as far
unconstitutional,
as I know,
because that's flat out in the Constitution.
Thank you. Yes, we have the only unelected sheriff in the entire country.
Was he appointed by, like, the Nassau County Commission or something?
Yeah.
That's odd. Well, the county commission is elected, so.
No, I don't even remember who it is that actually appoints somebody. Somebody within the government that appoints.
For this argument, if the sheriff department isn't tied to property taxes, the sheriffs are still getting paid, and they're the ones who evict people for not paying property taxes. So even if you had 30% of a community not paying their property taxes, all the sheriff's department has to do is go one by one, because they're paid by the county. So one by one, evicting people, one a day. Hey, you're not allowed to be on this property because you won't pay your property tax, and that's losing your house is quite tragic.
I understand that, Dave. I'm just like
agree with you, but like take a lot of people to straight up say we're not paying our property taxes because of schools and them not to enforce that.
I don't think you realize what kind of numbers 30-40% would be in a certain area, man.
I'm just playing devil's advocate.
No, of course. Is there risk involved? Absolutely. It's the same we've discussed before. It's the same thing with the IRS and being somebody who wants to fight the whole income tax thing. There's risks involved, yes. But if you get a certain percentage of the population on your side and willing to, it's the whole idea. They can't arrest everybody. They can't. They just can't.
They don't have
the more people that keep doing that, then other people will see. And if anything else, they'll be pissed off that they're still paying, and they'll not pay out of spite, because they'll be like, well, if they're not going to pay, then I'm not going to pay. And that's how we crashed your system. We're far away from numbers on anything like that. I was just positing that I think if you got it that high, if it's only like 10-15% of the population, you're absolutely right. Yes, most likely it would be enforced, but there's every law, there's only a certain amount that can be enforced. Once enough people oppose, and it's different for every law, and it's, you know, whatever, you know, whatever the state wants to protect itself, however the state wants to protect itself, and which areas where their line is drawn, where they'll be like, well, okay, if enough people do this, then we're going to, you know, implore all this force to stop it, or, you know, wherever that is, it varies for each law. But there's a number, man. There's a number for every single one of them where it's just, you get enough people, it becomes unenforceable, and they can no longer do anything about it.
I 100% agree. I would just, logistically, it would have to be an overwhelming percent for that, especially the way property taxes are tied, because essentially you don't own your land in this country. You rent it from the state. So it's, you know, it's when rubber meets. Everyone wants to be an anarchist until the time to hold a gun.
I've said it a ton of times before. It's all about putting things into action. It's doing it. It's living it.
So
some people have to take these risks, and when they do, it helps show others that it is possible. And it, you know, and that applies to everything. And I think this is another one. You know. I'd be willing to stay here and fight if I have to. If I can't move out of the state, well, I'm going to fight the laws as much as I possibly can.
It's funny when I talk to people about homeschooling or unschooling, or even like if you refuse, let's say, vaccines for your kid, you know, then they ask, isn't that illegal? and it just makes me, you know, I try not to laugh, because I know they're serious. But it's really, an appeal to authority. And it's just it just demonstrates the whole fear-based culture that we live in, that everything that they do is based on, you know, is it legal or is it illegal, right? So basically, you know, you're admitting that you are the property of the politicians, right? The politicians are your masters. And it's just so it's so sad when I hear that. And you got to speak gently to these people, because you don't want to say you're a slave, because that's not always the best answer in such a situation. But I start going. It's not about legal or illegal, right? It's just about do you really think that your child will learn the best in a group of 30 kids or 20 kids? You know, and I tell people, like, people accuse me, you know, you think all teachers are evil. No, I don't think all teachers are evil. I think there's really genuinely, you know, compassionate and kind-hearted people who want to be teachers. They want to teach and, inspire kids. But the problem is they're functioning in a monopoly that does not respond to it has no feedback. It, you know, doesn't respond to incentives, so it's an inflexible and oppressive system. And so, regardless if they want to inspire or not, you only get 38 minutes to inspire, and then ding, 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 next class.
That reminds me of a point I wanted to make earlier. As how you were saying, Baltimore schools spent $19,000 a student. If you guys think that's being spent on the students directly, you're out of your mind. I don't necessarily mean you guys, but like anybody listening, you're out of your mind if you think that this money is going toward the kids. Go check their textbooks. They probably have textbooks from 1997. They probably have computers that are, you know, like Pentium 2s in them. And they probably have all this old, outdated shit and all this old books. The money is going to these teachers' unions, okay? They're not going toward the students. These teachers' unions get these teachers in these contracts where they're owed pensions and all this other shit. And that's where the bulk of your money is going. That's why another reason why it's so important to get your kids out, because yeah, the few teachers that do care, they're kind of overshadowed by these grumpy dinosaurs who know they have job protection. They're not going anywhere.
Well, it's not only that, John, but the curriculum that they're taught is forced curriculum. It's not like when you go in, it's not like when you go into college and you're in economics 301. You know, it's not like that. It's not like where you're actually getting to hear what someone's genuinely thinking about the subject. It's, hey, you're going to do this or you're going to get fired, teacher. Hey, and you're tenured, so you can't really get fired as long as you just play along. So just shut up, do your job, and collect your paycheck. That the unions destroy incentives for workers to work harder.
And we can take the anarchy slant here and say that the good teachers would do far better work and make far more money in a truly free market where they were able to, you know, sell their skills as a teacher, a tutor, a math tutor, whatever. And they could probably do a lot better and teach a lot better if they didn't have this big, giant state bureaucracy over their shoulder saying, do this, do this, do this, and, you know, do this. They would fare a lot better in a freer market.
I 100% agree, John. You nailed it right there. And, you know, you tell a teacher that, you know, my aunt is she's a special needs teacher for the state school, for one of the state schools. And me and her get into big arguments about the AEA, which is the Alabama Education Association, which is the big teachers union and stuff. And, you know, and I say, do you know that there's three state senators on the AEA payroll? They don't work. They work one day a year. They come in and go, yeah, I work here. And they get paid $800,000 a year.
Oh, my God. Are you kidding me?
No. I'm not kidding you. And they're state senators.
That's not a conflict of interest at all.
So I sit here and I tell her, we're paying into these schools. I'm sure there's some schools downtown, if we're going to be pragmatic in this approach, they could use $800,000. Wouldn't you agree? Even if it was for just updated textbooks or better gym facilities or what, I mean, what the fuck ever, you know?
And that's what makes me laugh about these statists who say, oh, we need to spend more money on our education. Like, are you kidding? We already outspend the entire world on education. How much more do you want to spend? And you know what? If the money was actually going to textbooks and updated computer labs and updated everything, I might not have that big of a problem with it, other than the morality of theft and taxation and all that stuff. But they don't spend it on that stuff. They don't buy things for the kids. They spend it all on teacher salaries and, you know, bureaucratic bullshit behind the scenes.
Well, yeah, exactly. I was going to say, it's not because, I mean, I grew up, I was raised by two educators who, you know, both have now turned their back on the system finally after all these years. But to stick up for teachers just a little bit, it's not, you said it, the bureaucracy, because a lot of it isn't even the teachers. Yes, they're promised these pensions, but those fall into the, you know, the unfunded liabilities that every, you know, that every other, that would now for like federally and nationally, I think goes up to like $200-300 trillion or something like that is estimated now. If you add them all together. But it's administrative costs, because on top of the teachers, because it's not like they flood the schools with teachers, because they just keep adding more and more kids to the classroom. You know, there's some places where there's 30, 35, 40 kids in a class.
It's one teacher? I mean,
exactly. So it's not the teachers. Like, yeah, they get promised money, but up front, some of them get paid, but a lot of it, it just, there's more administrators for every teacher. Like they have like one administrator or two administrators and then secretaries. And then, you know, you know, it's the office space scenario, boss on top of boss, on top of boss, on top of boss, on top of boss with all their little underlings. And they're all paid with the same, that's where the money goes. But people say, oh, if we just spend more money, because they, well, aside from the fact that most of them don't understand basic economics, they don't understand that the, like you said, the money's not going to the kids, but they're just, they're conditioned to, well, if we just throw more money at the problem, if we just throw more money at the problem, we're not throwing enough money at the problem. That must be it, you know, because teacher, because the teachers unions get their base rallied up for raises and whatever else it is. And they go out there and they tug on the heartstrings of people and say, oh yes, you have to vote for, you know, the bigger budget and you have to vote for this. You know, and the teachers' unions, of course, know full well that the money's not actually going to go even to the teachers, much less the kids.
Yeah, I love them. Vote for this or else you hate the kids.
Well, exactly. But that's
and,
what
and
that's
a lot of teachers' unions aren't voluntary.
No, yeah. I've
a lot of unions aren't voluntary.
In Alabama, it is. They cannot force you to be in the AA. But if you're not in the AA, it's worse. It's so much worse to be a teacher.
Is Alabama a right to work state? Is that
It is. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I have always found that so ludicrous that people champion that. It's like you have to get a law passed so you have a right to work where want for what. No, that's ridiculous. You
that's
just
not
do
what
it
right.
anyways. No, that's what right. No, right to work means that you don't you can't be forced into the unions.
It means that and also
is,
employers
statists think it's a positive thing.
No.
It's ridiculous.
It means that you cannot you cannot be forced into a union in government jobs. And also it means that you cannot you can be fired for any reason. That's the big thing why a lot of liberals are against it, because
but you should
be able to, I walk in, hey, I don't like the way your glasses sit on your nose, Jeremy, you're fired. And you have no legal and that fucks that scares the shit out of liberals because they think a job is a right.
Well, of course. But if you didn't sign an explicit contract with your employer beforehand, then well, that's your fault. And if he wants to fire you, he wants to fire you. Well, I would just say it's just funny because a lot of people would think that's a good thing, and in the statist paradigm, I guess it is. But it's just funny that you because people when people get excited when they you know when they talk about passing that law, oh, we're trying to become a right to work state, like. You have to get a law passed to have the right to work.
What
are you insane?
Cooch Brothers Shill. Shill, you Cooch Brothers Shill.
Yes. As you can tell by my fabulous, you know, backdrop here, I'm rolling in the Coke dough.
Rolling in the dough.
I'm gonna mail you a Coach Enterprises or whatever their corporate logo is so you can put it up behind your thing as a joke.
So another way for me that the government schools kind of break up the family is they really take up the most valuable time during the day, right? And like the kids have to wake up, you know, at absurd hours, right? And so they don't get a moment to relax in the morning, right? And then they rush off to school, and then most of them have after school activities, right? Because the parents work, right? So they want them to keep them busy, and many of them get home 5-6 o'clock, right? And so you only have a few hours there where you gotta do your homework, eat dinner, you know, chat with your family, and go to bed early so you can go to sleep and wake up early again the next day to repeat the whole thing, right? So you're destroying the whole free time of the week. And then on the weekend, all that free time is like stress because you're like, we got to enjoy this because we only have 2 days to enjoy each other.
And conditioning.
And if one of those days, you know, something awful happens, then it's like everybody's stressed out. it's amazing.
Conditioning.
Of course.
They're conditioning you to be a 9-to-5 tax cow. That's exactly what they're prepping you for.
Yeah,
Danilo, are you planning to move out of New York to escape regulation hell?
Yeah, we are thinking about it. We're still considering which destination to go. But yeah, New York is pretty oppressive. So,
may I not suggest West Virginia?
Not suggest why?
I just wouldn't go there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I'm definitely looking at New Hampshire in a year. I mean, their homeschool laws are pretty much equal to Connecticut. Their laws are, you write the letter to pull your child out of school, and you're supposed to keep a portfolio of everything your child does, any worksheets or projects or anything you do, you're supposed to keep a portfolio. But legally, you're not obligated to show that to anybody. So it's almost like you don't need to keep a portfolio.
How do you keep a portfolio? You know, it's funny. I've actually...
It makes no sense.
Well, no, to them it makes sense because you have to have some kind of evidence. But who? I think I might have heard Brett Vanat talking about it on the School Sucks podcast about how that was one of the things that he actually, when he was a public school teacher, and he was involved in the system, that he actually thought that was kind of a cool thing when he was stepping out of that, because it's like, yeah, if you don't have to, but it's still a cool to, you know, if to hold on to for later in life, so you could look at it as a, maybe as a proud parent or as the kid.
But here's my portfolio. You can't look in it.
But the whole point is not only, I mean, you could,
maybe
but
keep one for yourself. Sure.
Realistically, how do you keep a portfolio of a real world education?
You don't.
How do you exactly? Unless you're taking pictures of everything. And
Timmy
that's
learned
in.
How to tie his shoe yesterday. The loop, swoop, and pull.
Well, not even that. I was just talking about going out to, like John said, to like the museums or the nature walks. Like that's how you spend your day. That's how your kid learns and wants to do things. Yeah. How do you keep that in a portfolio?
It's intangible. Let me take you on a tour.
Well, there are states that require it. So yeah, here you go. Let me take you on a tour. Come hang out with us one day. You'll see what we do. Here's your portfolio.
I can say this as an unschooling parent that, I mean, there are a lot of days when we don't do anything. We just kind of hang around and chill out all day. I mean, you really got it right when you were describing a day in public school in the morning, rush around, because every parent out there listening with kids in public schools is pretty familiar with this phrase, 5 more minutes, 5 more minutes, turns into 15, turns into 20, turns into where's your fucking shoes? The bus is coming right now. And it's
sad,
rushing around,
sad.
It's crazy, it's intense. They get on the bus, they go, they forgot their lunch. You got to get in the car, you can bring it to school. It's who needs it? Who needs it? We homeschool, and my daughter wakes up whenever she wakes up. She comes into my room and nudges me and asks to borrow my laptop because she wants to play Minecraft. And she makes her own breakfast. She'll get her own toast with peanut butter or whatever, you know, yogurt or a banana or whatever she can grab. She gets her own breakfast. She sets up her Minecraft, and she's good for hours. And she's shown me cities that she has built on Minecraft. Like, it blew my mind that a 7-year-old did this.
Yeah. One of the funniest questions I get asked is, you know, when I talk about homeschooling, and they say, "So, how many hours a day do you homeschool?" And to me, that you know, it refers back to our own government schooling, where, you know, you go to school at these, you know, block of hours, and then at this block, you're not at school.
Did you do you tell them you left your time card at home?
So I'm like, no, it's not like that. Like, you know, like Jeremy was saying, you know, there is no separation between living and learning, right? You're always learning, you know. You're always learning. So, I like to describe it as, you know, passion-driven education or child-driven education, or some people say life education, something like that. But, to think that learning only occurs in a certain block when you sit down and you put a pen to a piece of paper and you start writing letters and numbers, no.
You know, you're absolutely right. And that brings me to the point of people who homeschool as opposed to unschool. When you're homeschooling with the curriculum, now, this may be miles better than public education because at least you control what goes into your child's mind, but you're still doing the routine at home. I mean, maybe you're not waking up ass early in the morning to rush around and all that, but you're still doing a regimented, this is time for this, this is time for this, this is time for that. And which is why I was really drawn to unschooling, is because I really believe that if a child is learning something, geez, let them, leave them alone. Let them run with it. Let them take it as far as they can.
Yeah. Yeah. When I talk to people, I usually say homeschooling. I don't say unschooling. Number one, because most people are not familiar, but number two, even just the word homeschooling is radical enough for most people to like, whoa.
Yeah.
So I just start from there, and then I say there's a wide spectrum of homeschoolers, right? You got the homeschoolers that are like, they do exactly what is done in government school just at home, right? That's the first level, and then all the way to the, you know, to the unschooling level where it's just complete freedom. So, and then I introduced the word unschooling. So
I first learned the word unschooling at Porkfest. Not this past one, but the one before 2014. I was at a homeschool meet and greet, and I had known that I wanted to homeschool for a while, and I was going to Porkfest, and they just happened to have this meet up there, a homeschool meet and greet. So I ran into these two ladies, Connie, and I can't remember the other one's name, and they were telling me that they were unschoolers. They said, well, what the hell is unschooling? I've never heard of this. They told me what it was, and I was like, these ladies are batshit insane. They let their kids sit around and play Minecraft all day. I'm not happy. But it was intriguing, so I listened to them, and the more they spoke, the more they made sense. And the more questions I had, the more they were right there with a counter answer to it. And I started thinking, I was like, wow, this really isn't some kind of fringe weirdo thing. Like, these people are actually doing it. And their kids are right here, and they're the most well-behaved, well-adjusted children I've ever seen. So, I mean, I hate to use anecdotal evidence like that, but when it's right there, it's really hard to argue with.
Mm-hmm.
I looked into unschooling a little bit more, and I got to say, I really like it, and mm-hmm. I can't imagine doing it any other way.
What's on everyone's mind that's hearing this, that has children, that's in a spousal relationship or has a partner or whatnot? How did you have any friction from your wife for this idea? I mean, and if so, how did you deal with it?
I had no resistance from my wife at all. I pretty much came home and said, hey, listen, I learned about this method of unschooling. You know, we wanted to homeschool for a while. And I said, you know, this is the gist of it. It's kind of life-led learning. The child kind of learns whatever they're interested in. And as lucky as I was, she was on board right away, which I absolutely, you know, I'm not a religious person, but that right there was a blessing. And there's really no other word for it because... I mean, if your spouse is not on board, this could cause some major, major problems. I mean, this is an issue that you both need to be on board with. And if you're both not on board 100%, there's going to be issues. So try and work this out with your spouse beforehand.
Yeah,
I can imagine it would lead to many fights.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, especially if one is really dead set, you know, oh, no, children need to go to school. And you're over here, well, I'm learning about this homeschooling thing. And, you know, what if your spouse digs their heels in the sand and says, no, they need to go to school. Everybody goes to school. It's what you do. You're going to have some problems. I mean, I would have, because I don't want my daughter going to these places because I know how it is in there. I know what they do. We had her in public school kindergarten for a year, so I was able to see, you know, up close what she was bringing home, what kind of books she was reading, what kind of punishments they dole out for stupid things like talking in class. My daughter got a note home. She had a behavioral notice for sitting there twirling her hair.
Seriously?
Yeah, twirling her hair. She got a behavioral.
That's so sad.
She wasn't paying attention. You know?
Well, in fairness, did she ask permission to twirl her hair first?
That was the problem.
That was the problem.
I mean, why do you send your kids to an institution where they have to ask permission to use the bathroom? I mean, come on.
Well, because they'll be goofing off if they could just go wherever they want, nilly-willy.
I mean, maybe that's what they need. Maybe these kids need to goof off a little. I mean, my kid's a nut sometimes. She's really goofy, and we encourage that. Why stifle that?
Absolutely.
So, well, I was being facetious.
Yeah. I was just gonna say. I mean, I think most people just, you know, they look at it like, well, you know, of course people have to go there because that's what happened to them. They were told they had to go and they went, and the same thing happened to their parents. But you know, to touch on what you were saying with the, you know, with Dave's question about the if one partner is not involved, I mean, I think that the three of us here that are either unschooling or going to be unschooling are all lucky to have, you know, our spouse, you know, because Danilo, your wife's obviously, well, she wants to follow the rules for it, but she's at least on board with the whole idea of homeschooling, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I mean, I'm in the same position. That's, you know, we've talked about that before. I was very lucky that I knew that I was going to homeschool my kids before they were even born, because my wife and I talked about it when we first got together about the idea of having kids and what we wanted to do, when we both had said that, you know, homeschooling was something we were interested in. And you know, I heard about unschooling through, I think it was Dayna Martin. I think I heard her interviewed on Berwick's show. And that was the first time I, you know, like you, when you went to Porkfest and just heard it from these people, I had the same reaction to Dayna Martin the first time I heard it. She's insane. This woman's crazy. What the hell is she talking about? But then when I started following her stuff a little bit more, and then I saw her kids, you know, who all, I think all of them are, or at least at the time, were 15 and under, and I think all but one of them, and that maybe that was like the youngest one, had at least one business up and running already.
I know, right?
And two of them had like three or four different businesses running at the same time that they were turning like a minimal, but still turning a profit. at like 8, 9, 11, 13 years old, they're running their own businesses.
But capitalism is evil, Jeremy.
Well, it
suppresses the working class. Okay.
See, that's the funny
thing. You bourgeoisie. Oh, anyways. Well,
most casual socialist and communist who would make claims like that against capitalism would actually think it's cute that a kid's doing it, and they wouldn't equate the two. They wouldn't see it as capitalism. They would just see it as a kid doing so, like a lemonade stand. Oh, because even some of them get up in arms.
That's why there's child labor laws, Jeremy.
Well, of course. if it wasn't for the government and the child labor laws, your kid would still be working in a coal mine. Gosh, exactly. Don't.
What if the kid is the boss?
Well, exactly. Then?
Do we have I think we just divided by zero.
So I do have to say, this past year when I went back to Porkfest, I ran into Connie, the lady who taught me about unschooling. And I got to say, I walked up to her and I said, thank you. It was so amazing what I've seen the last year out of my daughter. So I feel like I have to say that, because earlier I said her ideas were batshit insane, and at the time I did think that, but I do need to follow up with that.
I didn't hear about unschooling until I was already a voluntarist, and even when I heard it, I was like, I don't know, this is kind of batshit insane.
Yeah,
because you always think about what you would do if this was your parents letting you be unschooled. Like, I'd be fucking the Xbox. I would already be on my fifth Xbox. But I'm like the worst. I mean, I'm the fucking worst. But what does that mean? Like, I could go into a career in video games or something, you know? So,
and that's what I tell parents. That's what you know. I wanted to get into myth. And we can do that in a second. But yeah, I mean, if you're into video games, go learn computers, go learn computer programming and, you know, computer science, and go follow your passions and do what you're good at. You never know what you can come up with.
The way I look at unschooling is, child-driven education is it's done from a state of humility, you know, that we don't know what they should know. Right, for the rest of their lives. We don't know what's going to be applicable in 20 years, right? Or even in 10 years, you know? It's like, I tell people, you know, like 20 or like, let's say 25 years ago, or 30, 25 years ago, you know, before the internet, who could have predicted the internet, right? And in 25 years, what's going to happen then, right? And so it's really amazing how people are so sure. What was that?
I said robot overlords. Keep going.
Yeah. So it's really amazing to me when people are so sure this is what you have to know to be a success in life. How do you know that? Mm-hmm. How do you know where the world's going to be in 25 years? It's such a, you know, a statement of hubris and arrogance to say that. And that's why I love voluntarism and anarchy, is that that's what we're saying. We don't know how people should live their lives. We don't know what kids should know because every kid is unique. Every kid has unique abilities and weaknesses. And you know, let the child be free to pursue whatever interests, you know, they come across, because you never know where that's going to lead. You never know, right?
Ooh, pick me. I know how people should live their lives.
Yes.
By leaving me the fuck alone.
Good one, dude.
Exactly. So yeah,
there's your bumper.
That's how I look at unschooling. It's done from a state of humility, and the same thing with voluntarism. It's all about humility.
Sure.
I think the idea that people, you know, because I did the same thing. I thought unschooling was batshit crazy when I first heard about it, because I assumed, just like Dave was saying, that, you know, you think of yourself and you think of. But it is, if you're into video games, that's one thing. You could definitely go into computer stuff. But I look back at myself, and I did become obsessed with video games, but I don't think it was because I liked them. And that I said, and I've talked to other people that I think this is also the case for, you needed to find a way to release.
Escape.
Yeah.
And it's Jinx. it's very easy to become obsessed with something when you're forced into this structured lifestyle. Mm. And, you know, as we were talking about earlier, about the getting up early and being at school like all day, you know, like getting up early. I remember, I mean, I was a bus driver back in the day, and my first stop picking up kids was at like 6:15 in the morning. Like, I had to be there. I had to be once I got to keep the bus at my house, I was allowed to leave a little later, but I had to pick my first kid up by 6:15 in the morning. 6:15.
How many times did you smoke the weed in that bus? Be honest.
Not once.
Not once. Okay. All right.
I did get fired for failing a drug test, but I absolutely never smoked on the bus.
Okay.
Be an improvement. How many
but
drivers being drunk taking kids to school?
I was not. What's his name? What was the guy? Otto. I was not Otto. All right.
Otto and
but what I was
from Simpsons.
Yes. Right. Exactly. But what I was saying is, I think for some people, at least a lot of the ones I've encountered, and again, obviously this is anecdotal, but because you're in this structured environment, it's very easy to become obsessed with something like video games or anything else, because that limited amount of free time you have, that's all you want to do. So if you look back on your childhood, like if you're somebody who went to public school and you're presented with the idea of homeschooling or unschooling, and your first idea is, which is a common myth, oh, your kids are just going to run wild. They're not going to learn anything. They're just going to sit and play video games all day, because you think of yourself, and maybe not just because you enjoyed playing them, but because that's all you did with the limited amount of time you were given.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah.
Because that's all you had. If you had all the time in the world, would you really be playing video games all day long? Wouldn't you get bored?
Look, if I only had an hour to myself every day, and that's, you know, that's a stretch for public schools, because like you said, you know, they go to school until, you know, 3-4 o'clock, they come home, they've got 2 hours of homework, they've got their karate practice or football or baseball or
homework,
whatever it is, yeah, and more homework, and then somewhere in there you got to fit in dinner and a shower and go to bed and wake up and do it all again the next day. You have no free time. So yeah, the hour of free time you get, yeah, all I want to do is play my video game. But if I had all day to do what I want, playing the video games would probably get a little boring after a few hours, but maybe I can look up some videos on computer programming. Maybe I can find some books on programming.
Yeah, I interviewed Katie Testa, who's also an unschooler, and she mentioned this interesting concept that, you know, there's two different types of questions. You know, there's the question where, you know, you know the answer, or the true question where you don't know the answer. So it's like if somebody comes out, you know, you tell your child, you know, we do unschooling, and then they come up to your child condescendingly, right, and say, so what is 2 + 2? Right? That's like a fake question.
Yeah.
Or a real question would be, you know, what is the moon made of? Well, I don't know. Let's go find out. Right? Right. So it's funny that, you know, especially the older, you know, much older generation, when I talk about unschooling, they really measure homeschoolers you know, more homeschoolers based on the knowledge and education that they had, right? So, for example, you know, my grandfather, he has a PhD in physics and chemistry, right? So what do you think he thinks is important for kids to know? Right? So, yeah. You know, he's
culinary,
like,
skills?
Right. And it's kind of laughable that you know, that's kind of what he's asking of my kids, you know, is like, do they know mathematics? Like, you know, basic stuff. Like, it's just amazing how we always are judging the competence of other people. Yeah. Based on our own knowledge, you know.
I did want to run down some myths if you guys want to change.
Sure.
Yeah.
Gears and go towards some myths. All right. Well, I mean, to recap for the people watching, you've heard all four of us rail on public school for you know, an hour now, and you should understand why these places are bad. You've got to get your kids out. If you have to move, if you have to change jobs, if you have to, you know, do what you got to. Then where do you start? Check your state laws, make sure, do what you have to do, fill out the forms, write the necessary paperwork that you have to do, and get them out. Now, once they're out, you probably have some questions about some myths that people say. I'll throw the first one out there. The all-time obvious, most rampant myth about homeschooling is, what about the social aspect?
Socialization.
Socialization.
Oh my God!
I'm sure you've heard that one.
Yes, I've heard that one.
That gets me.
Yeah. I mean, let's come on. We're all smart adults here. We can have an internet that we use, and with this magic interwebs, we can connect with other people who are doing the same things that we're doing. My wife is involved in 2 or 3 different homeschool groups on Facebook. I'm involved in 1 or 2 of them, and find local ones. There's one Facebook group, a local one around here. Every year, we actually, believe it or not, we actually live like 10 minutes away from one of the only drive-in movies left in the like entire area.
Wow.
So the first night that they're open, they have to test the reels and, you know, test the machinery and make sure everything's working right. Well, the admin of the homeschool group that we're in is friends with the owner. So the owner says, well, we'll have a homeschool night here and, you know, let everybody in your group know. Everybody can come. It's free to everybody because we have to test these things anyway. Just maybe encourage people to buy something from the snack bar and they can watch free movies. And the place was full of homeschool kids and full of homeschooling parents, and the kids ran around and played in front of the movie screen while it was still daylight. And then when it got dark, they all went back to the cars, and my daughter made a friend and went back to his car and sat with his mommy and had popcorn and watched the movie, and it was great. I mean, there's so much you can do for socialization.
There's sports, there's all kinds of stuff, yeah.
Yeah, there's all kinds of things. Anybody who says, what about the socialization, to me, unfortunately, that puts a big red mark on you that you haven't done 5 minutes of research into homeschooling. You don't know what it is. You don't know what it's about. You know, you're just parroting talking points that you hear other people say. You haven't done any research at all. If the socialization is your biggest issue, you haven't researched homeschooling at all.
I think a lot of it too is a fear that admittance that maybe they're being a bad parent or a shitty parent, one could say, by sending their kid to a public school.
Yeah, I mean, you know, look at what's in public school. You've got, you know, kids who are being thrown in public school as a means of babysitting. They've got no parental direction at home. They've got no moral compass at all. I mean, it's almost literally prison for children. The socialization that you're getting in public schools is not the socialization that you want your children to grow up with. And I know some people are real hard asses and they say, well, you got to send them to learn how to deal with the assholes of life. And I'm over here like, why would you want to subject them to that shit to begin with? Just teach them disassociation and they're good to go.
Right. Yeah. Well, my argument against the socialization issue is tied to that a little bit. You know, obviously the social, like you said, the socialization you get there. I mean, that's where the bully culture is bred.
Yep.
And it just gets extended into adulthood, and that's when, you know, the bullies, in school usually often become the bullies, and you know, when they get older, you know, they become cops or they go into the military,
border patrol.
Yeah, exactly. But also the for me,
or
when
bus
people,
driver.
When hey now. When people
sorry.
When people say you know, the socialization, aside from that, my second point is, well, aren't you worried about your child getting an education? What does that have anything to do with socialization? Socialization is not supposed to be a part of school. You're supposed to be learning. You're not
yeah, go ahead.
Oh no, I was just gonna, so that's part of my argument too. Like, why are you so concerned? And then also, in their mind, you're learning to socialize, but who are you being taught to social? You're being forced to socialize with people your age.
And it also implies that, like, you can't be a social person unless you're thrown into school. Like, if you don't go to school, you'll be socially awkward. And it's like, how many people did we all know in high school that were socially awkward, that went through 12 years of public schooling, and if anything, they're more socially awkward going out than when they went in.
Yes, we call them the nerds, the geeks, you know, the spazzes. That was me. You know, yeah. So I know all about that. Sure. You know, but like I said, that, I mean, socialization is like, you're being forced to socialize with kids your own age. You're surrounded by kids your own age. Mm-hmm. How, you know, that's not socialization. That's central planning.
Yeah.
How are you going to tell me that a kid that is, you know, a young child that is forced to be around other kids, just other kids his age, maybe a year, you know, either direction, and then maybe get occasional interaction with kids a little bit older, a little bit younger, depending on where the school is, depending on how many grades are in one school. How are you going to tell me that child, even if you take away the bullying aspect, how are you going to tell me that that child is any more, is better socialized than one who gets to spend most of their lives with friends doing other things where they're not being forced to do it and being around adults and not ones that are just standing in front of them in front of the classroom being authoritarian and being, you know, and telling them what to do, interacting, having real conversations with older people and expanding their vocabulary and expanding their ability to grasp concepts and logic and reason at light years before any of us were ever given the opportunity to do so. Like, how are you going to tell me that that second child is not the better socialized one? Like, that's insane. But again, like you said, it's just the rhetoric that people have been taught. That's all they know. They haven't bothered. Oh yeah, you're not getting socialization, so you're going to end up being this miserable person who can't, you know, they anticipate homeschoolers to either end up being serial killers or what's the word where you won't leave the house. What's that? I always forget what that's called. Were you afraid to leave the house? The disease.
Agoraphobia.
Yeah, is that it? Yeah, you're either gonna become that, or you're gonna become a serial killer. It can't possibly come out any other way.
Just watch any Hollywood movie that mentions homeschooling, and you'll see the stereotype.
Exactly.
Yeah. But
my cousins were both homeschooled, and both of them are very well adjusted people. They weren't unschooled; they were like legit, straight up homeschooled, but. They were a little socially awkward sometimes, but that's just because when you get around 16, 17, you're operating on a different wavelength if you're going to a public school than someone who is going to homeschool. Like, you may not be as exposed to certain things, and, you know, that's where the parent's job is to step in and expose that child in a safer manner than, you know, learning about sex in school, learning about drugs. I mean, I doubt those kids, my cousin, saw or heard of drugs until they were 17 or 18. And, you know, first time I ever took a drug, I was probably 14, 13. You know, and that wouldn't have happened at home.
Yeah.
Most likely. Yeah. I mean, I can't say for sure, but most likely.
Yeah, Jeremy was talking about being around different age groups, and yeah, like when I go out with you know, my friends, they yeah, my kids are around all different age groups, and what's beautiful is that, like, you know, Jeremy said, you know, they're interacting with adults in not an authoritarian manner, and that's so beautiful. My kids talk to adults as equals, basically. They don't cower, they're not afraid, you know, they most often speak their mind, and you know, that's great. I love that. You know, they're not afraid. You know, they're not afraid when they see an adult. They don't feel like an inferior. You know, and that's how most kids are basically trained to feel. You know, when you go to school, right? This authority figure. You ask permission. You raise your hand. You know, you don't speak unless spoken to. And it's really, really sad that kind of you know, almost like a slave mentality that's driven into most of us. Well, and it's difficult to break. But yeah.
This definitely ties into peaceful parenting. Peaceful parenting and homeschooling really do go hand in hand. We treat our daughter like an equal. She's a smaller equal, but she is an equal. We don't pull rank on her. We don't say, yeah, I'm the father, that's why.
Right. Yeah.
You know, she's a little kid, but we don't talk to her in that goofy baby voice that some stupid grown-ups do.
Here's one of the things I always think about punishment in this peaceful parenting thing. You can teach them a very quick lesson on capitalism and use that as punishment, you know, like, hey, could you help me clean the house? No. Okay, well, I'm not going to help you get food tonight. You know, like, I need a little give and go here. You've got to do something to get this. You know, there's a supply and demand here, and right now, you get what I'm saying. The supply of this food is in high demand by you helping me clean this house.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not so sure I'd go that far. It's funny enough.
I mean, I really don't know how to wrap my head around it, but I don't have kids, so I'm not really in that position. But, you know, if a kid's acting out, I mean, I just got my ass beat, so I really don't know.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we could dedicate an entire episode, to peaceful parenting.
Yeah, we should do that, definitely.
Yeah, sure, I'd be game. There's plenty of other people who I can recommend to come on, too. Mm. But anyway, back to homeschooling is that, we treat her as an equal, and that goes hand-in-hand with peaceful parenting. There was another point I was going to make. I completely slipped my mind. I'm sorry about that. Another myth, and that was something I think it was you, Danilo, who mentioned it before, was people worried about if your kids are up to snuff or up to par. And it's like, well, what if they're not up to snuff with other kids their age?
Right.
To that I answer, so what? Mm-hmm. So your kid is slightly behind other average 8-year-olds in math. Who cares? Math is what your child wants to learn and wants to study. They'll learn it and they'll study it. If they need it, they will learn it.
I constantly keep going back to these homeschooling mothers, but they're good examples, I'm telling you.
I'm done with this.
It's good research to draw back on. But you know,
I'm just gonna make one giant edit to send to Monica. It's just gonna have Danilo in different shirts, in different positions, saying stuff about homeschooling mothers and all these homeschooling mothers and these ladies I hang out with and my friends.
Is this a homeschooling mothers brothel or something? What is this?
She knows what's going on. I'm telling you, she knows.
All right.
Anyway, you were saying.
So to go from what John is doing, you know, like, which is, you know, complete freedom for the kid, whatever, you know, respect whatever they want to do. And then some of the homeschoolers that I meet, they're like, they got their kid back to back to back to back in classes, you know, swim classes, diving classes, wrestling, you know, all these kinds of different things. And then they're telling me, like, you know, my kid can do kayaking, canoeing, swimming, diving, wrestling, you know, all these different things. And I'm joking. And I look at them, I'm like, well, my kid stop peeing in the bed. I guess that's good. That's good. So, I mean, it's just funny how, yeah, like you said, even amongst homeschoolers, there's that competition, you know. Are you, I don't know. I don't know if they do that intentionally, but yeah, I mean, yeah, it's not a competition. I mean, no. all kids advance differently.
I guess,
you know,
they're looking for validation.
Yeah.
I think so. And maybe they're looking for proof that homeschooling doesn't work. Like, aha, your child isn't up to snuff in reading, so ha, homeschooling doesn't work. I know.
Right, exactly.
Like, well, it doesn't really work like that. I mean, the whole point of homeschooling is individualized education. You're taking them out of an environment where everybody has to learn the same exact thing, and now you're putting them into an environment where you learn what you want to learn, and you learn what you like to learn. And if you don't like something, it doesn't interest you, you don't have to learn it. And that's okay.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we could go on and on with the list of misconceptions and myths and all this stuff. But I mean, this one, yeah, people, they don't, as far as, you know, checking in and being like, well, what do they know? That's exactly the point. They don't think about the fact that, well, why do you think that a kid at this age should know this? Mm-hmm. Because there's a one size fits all program out there. Like, it totally slips their mind. It just goes right over their head that's why you think that everybody should learn the certain thing at a certain time. But then they don't realize that that's why so many people fail, because they're forced to learn like everybody else. And it doesn't work that way, you know.
It's a forced paradigm. Right?
Yeah, I don't come across too many people that in both enjoyed their government indoctrination and felt that they learned, like they came away later in life knowing all these things. Like, yes, you'll meet the arrogant people that think they know everything about something, yeah. But on the whole, most people later in life, they don't take it to the logical conclusions, unfortunately, but they'll realize that they have to relearn something, or they have to go seek out to learn something that they were never taught. And unfortunately, most of them, it's just a fleeting thing where they'll think, hey, why didn't I ever learn this? And then the ADD kicks in and they go, oh, I can learn it right here. Okay. And then they forget why they didn't learn it in the first place. but it's that mentality. Like, people just, This is what I did. This is what my parents did. This is the way it goes. This people have to learn at a certain rate. They have to learn by a certain time. They have to know these things. And yeah. I mean, it's so silly, because, again, like you said, they just haven't bothered to research.
Yeah, holding someone back, you know, for like fourth or third or first grade, you know, yeah, they're not learning at they learn differently.
Yeah, everybody, you know, people, they like, you, if you think about it in your...
It crushes a kid psychologically. It crushes them.
It can, absolutely. I've met so many people that later in life finally had success, but it took them a long time because they thought they were dumb. And they weren't. They were told by the system that they were dumb. Exactly. They were told that because they were forced into remedial classes, because they may have been forced to repeat a grade, and it wasn't that they weren't trying. At some point they may have given up, but on the whole, it wasn't because they weren't trying. It just wasn't getting through to them in the way that it was forced on everybody else. So, you know, it's the freedom thing. I mean, obviously, as anarchists, we know freedom in general scares the ever-living piss out of most people.
It really does. Yeah.
It's that Larkin quote, you know. The most common response I get when I tell people they should be free is, no, I shouldn't. And it goes for schooling too. Telling people that, you know, maybe you should look at the fact that it may just be better to give your kid freedom. Let them figure things out.
To drive the indoctrination point home again, I think I might have mentioned this on the last program, is that they are cranking kids out of these schools, and they are telling these kids that it was necessary to drop not one but two atomic bombs on Japan and wipe out what 200,000 citizens. And these kids are coming out of school going, well, it was necessary to end the war, we had to do it. And if that's not screaming to you what this indoctrination is, I don't know how else to break it to you.
World War II got us out of the Great Depression. Why can't you understand that?
Jeremy made me think of another myth that I really want to go over. And I know the list of myths can be a mile long, but I really do want to get the big main ones that everybody seems to be hung up on. And that's one myth that I hear is, well, I would love to homeschool, but I just can't. I'm too dumb. I'm not qualified enough. Mm-hmm. I can't mm-hmm. teach. I'm not qualified to do this.
In my case, that's true.
Well, maybe it is. Maybe it is true, but that doesn't.
I'm joking. I'm really smart. I'm
I don't know that. So I mean, you don't need to be qualified to teach your kids. I mean, hand them an internet, hand them the laptop, and say, go to town, learn what you need to learn. Even if you do a lot of homeschooling curriculums these days, a lot of it is even the curriculums are self-taught, and you sit the kid down and they watch a video series on the lesson, and then they do, you know, a multiple choice thing on the website that they're doing the curriculum from or whatever it may be.
So maybe we'll finish up with this one as the last myth, and then we'll wrap it up. But that is a good that is a common complaint that I hear. You know, you're not qualified. You don't have a master's degree. You don't have a degree. You know, you don't have a license to teach. And I'm like, one of the first things I say is, do I have to be a master chef to cook dinner?
Yeah.
Do I have to be a NASCAR driver to drive my kids around to places they need to go?
It'd be more fun. Let's be real honest.
And let's say okay, for the sake of conversation, let's say you are too dumb. You don't know things. You don't understand what the child is learning. Learn with them. This is
an opportunity
for you to bond with your child and learn something together. Mm. Sit and relearn fifth grade math with them. Relearn some history. Give them the correct history.
That's gonna cut into my keeping up with the Kardashians time. And I just, yeah. I really, you know, it's just, I'd rather let the state do it because I'm a lazy bag of shit, you know?
Well, it also requires a lot of humility to be able to admit that you don't know and actually want to learn. Like, I mean, I'm somebody like that, obviously, because I realized that I was taught a whole bunch of crap, so I had to relearn a bunch of things. So I have no problem with that. Like, I look at, even if my wife wasn't as on board as she was, and even if she wasn't, even if she hadn't been a special education teacher in the past and has, you know, actually has degrees and all that stuff, like, I would still feel confident enough because I'm okay with saying, well, I don't know. And it goes back to that whole thing about, you know, when you said earlier, John, about, you know, the kids versus, you know, having being told what to learn and just being, well, this is how it is. And well, this is how it isn't, you know, if they maybe ask why, well, it's what it says in the book. So that's what we're going with. Like, that's the attitude of a lot of teachers because right. that's yeah. how they were taught. And it's like, well, this is what I was told. And this is, you know, so, but versus being at home and asking why. And the best thing you could do to not only encourage them to continue asking why, but also if you don't know, instead of saying, well, I don't know, go ask somebody else, say, I don't know. Why don't we go learn together? Let's go look it up. Let's go, you know. Exactly, because that's the thing. And because most people, like I said, it's a humility thing because a lot of people are afraid to admit they don't know certain things. And even if they're willing to kind of admit it, they don't think they can fix it. So they don't even think to say, well, maybe I'll take the class along with them. You know, that's like something like Tom Woods's stuff. that he just finished putting out for the Ron Paul curriculum. Like, I'm actually trying to save up money to buy his courses for me. I want to take his government history courses. Like, I'm willing to spend money on that because I'm sure mm-hmm. I can learn something from that, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's like, and then I'll have them for my kids when they get that age, if they're interested in it, they could learn
it. It's just a one-page book. It says government is bad, okay?
and that's the best part. I mean, you know, something that I actually absolutely love this is when my daughter asks me something and I say, well, you know what, honey, I don't know. Let's find out together. Let's go answer your question together, whatever it may be. And we can either you know, hop on Google or you know, go whatever it is, look it up and learn things together. I don't have a problem saying I don't know.
I'm too much of an asshole, John. If I had a kid and they're like, hey, Daddy, what's this? I'd be like, have you Googled it yet?
Google it.
Do not ask me until you have Googled it, and then I will Google it and find it for you.
Exactly.
I would be terrible.
Yeah, as John said before, some people probably shouldn't have kids.
Not naming names.
I was just reiterating a great point.
I don't
want
kids.
The timing totally coincidental. It was coincidental.
I don't want kids. I know this. I feel like I'm too selfish. Which, I don't know. I'd probably be like the best dad ever. Because
you're still young, David. You're at your age. I actually four or five years past you, I was still convinced I didn't want kids.
Like 40 years ago, someone my age would already be married and have like three kids and like, you know, so like, no, I'm not too young. I'm just,
no,
I'm 28.
You are too young, dude. I didn't have my kids until I was 34.
Yeah, that's because you didn't get laid till you was 34.
Dave, that was supposed to be our secret.
I only go for Danilo laughs. Like, you got to realize this. When Danilo's laughing, it builds me up for the rest of the week.
I'm not a child hater, but...
They should just, you know, live on Child Island and be raised by robots.
So you just brought up something else I just thought of, is that every parent wants their children to learn, besides government schooling, wants to learn exactly what they know, right? So, for example, I love chess, piano, and, you know, philosophy, right? For you to say, or yeah, so just say chess and piano. So, I could see most parents forcing their kids to learn chess and piano who love chess and piano. They're like, every kid should know chess and piano. Yeah? And that's the fundamental error, is that we always are imposing our own, you know, aptitudes and skills, what we think is important, onto our children, right? And the difference with volunteers and unschoolers is that we know that's not okay. It's not okay to force your kid to do what he hates or what he doesn't want to do, because he might and most likely will eventually hate it. That's how you foster hatred towards a particular subject or hatred towards learning in general. It's just forcing them to do things against their will. So you know, and the way that I would like my kid to learn chess and piano is perhaps by me playing it a lot, me playing chess and playing piano, and then showing them how much I love to do it. And if they pick it up, that's awesome. Like recently, my son, he's five. He's been asking me, I take out the chessboard a lot when we go out, and he's been asking me, you know, oh, let's play a game. So now we're playing, so it's pretty cool. And Monica's like, why haven't you done that before? I'm like, well, he didn't ask me.
So yeah, you don't want to.
I agree to a certain extent on your assertion there, Danilo. But like, I think back to myself as a kid, and like, my dad let me quit playing baseball. And like, I played baseball my whole life until my dad let me quit. And like, I know this sounds in a weird way, but I like, looking back on it, I kind of wished I had like the Tiger Woods daddy, you know, situation going on where like, he wouldn't let me quit. Cause like, I really don't know where that would have went. Cause everywhere I played baseball till I was 12. Every team I was either the best player or one of the best players. Like, my teammate is in the pros right now. So like,
if you're the best player but you hate it, I mean, what's the value of that though?
I didn't hate it. I was just lazy. Like, I wanted to play video games.
Or still, if that wasn't a value in your life, then still, I mean.
I kind of wished he would have Tiger Woods daddied me. Well, just been like, no, you're doing baseball and you're gonna like it. I really wished he would have.
You didn't want it enough.
All right, maybe I wished I could go back in time and like slap myself in the face.
Yeah, and hindsight's 20/20, brother. Everybody, all of us wish we could go back in time
for
something.
Yeah, you would have totally smoked weed in that bus if you would have. I mean, come on, you would have smoked that. You would have hotboxed that bus.
I would have started smoking cannabis a lot earlier in life. I definitely would have done that. But yeah,
it'd be funny to like fishbowl the school bus and then open the window and drive down, make like a chemtrail on the highway.
Oh, John.
Yeah, maybe one day I'll just have to confiscate one just to do that.
Let's go lightning round. Boom, boom, boom. All four of us. All right, you've got to pitch unschooling or homeschooling, non-state funded schooling. go ahead and do that. You've got to pitch that to the person who's even thinking about it. John, start first.
I have to start. Okay.
Well, I don't know. Let's go Danilo first, and then we'll go Jeremy, and then we'll save you. Or I'll go, and then you go last.
Okay, I'll wrap it up.
You keep changing the rules here. Okay.
Well, he's the guest. He should finish
this
up.
That's why we don't like to play with Dave, because he just changes the rules. He's like government. He just changes the rules on the fly.
I'm a goalpost-moving son of a bitch. I'm sorry. You know?
He gets a double roll of the dice, and he can print the money. Okay, yes. Go ahead.
Go ahead. I think you're starting.
Yeah, go ahead, Danilo.
No, you said you're going to start first, Dave.
Okay, all right. So, okay. Like, here's my thing, okay? If you're thinking about, if you have kids and you have them in
Hi,
a...
Michael.
If you have your kids in a state institution, please consider this. Take your kid out of state-ran education. Put them in private schools. Get them a tutor. Unschool them or homeschool them. Rob the state of your child's mind. That is the only thing I can say about this. Please rob the state of your child's mind. And I will pass it to Danilo.
I like to tell people, reflect on your history, on your experience in government school. Did you enjoy it? And if you did not, if you can honestly say you did not enjoy it, then how can you, with dignity and integrity, send your own offspring to go to a place that you absolutely hated? And is that not child abuse? To subject your child to something that you absolutely hated, you know. So that's what I would say.
Yeah. Well, I usually would. I mean, if we're talking about the quick elevator speech, I would. I would probably say something along those lines too, where it's, you know, think back on how you felt going there. And on the flip side of that, if you claim to have enjoyed it, the next thing you'll look at is, how much of what you learned do you actually use in your everyday life?
All of it.
Like, how much, you know, the old, you know, remember back to when you were in school and you asked your, you know, maybe you asked, why do we need to know this? Are we ever going to use this in when we grow up? And some teachers may have been honest with you, and other teachers may have, you know, blown smoke up your ass. But, you know, think back to that and say, okay, really, how much of what you learned do you use?
But Jeremy, it's just to make you a well-rounded individual.
Well, yeah, but again, also remember that, you know, if you're thinking back to when you were, also think about how much technology has advanced since then. Oh, and yeah. just even think in your own daily life, if you need to learn something, are you able to do it relatively quickly on your own by just going to the internet and typing in some words and getting kicked back result, like thousands of results? Okay, if you can do that, why can't your child?
Think about the poor people that don't have internet, Jeremy. Come on.
Hey, you can steal Wi-Fi from just about anyone.
How else are they going to learn the Pythagorean theorem, okay?
One of the things with the aforementioned, what do you use in your everyday life?
Me and Danilo was telling me about it when he was talking about homeschooling moms, so I don't know. John?
I can see that as a name for a possible website. Homeschooling moms, I don't know. Okay.
Hot co-ed homeschooling moms. Anyway.
I guess I can say, like, if you're listening to this podcast, chances are you're not a statist. You've already woken up. You've already seen shit for what it is. Why do you keep your children in these schools? You know how bad they are. And I'm not trying to be like a preacher or anything. I'm not trying to tell you what to do. I just want you to question why your children are in these places to begin with. Like Jeremy said, you don't use half this stuff in your everyday life. There's no need for your kids to be in here. After everything you've seen on the podcast here, and I'm sure other podcasts cover it too, you can find great information on YouTube and you know, books and groups and all that stuff. Ask yourself why they're still in there, and is there anything I can do to change that to get them out? You're not a statist. You don't want the state raising your children, which is what you do when you put them in public school. So I really want to end it by saying, if you still have any questions, please contact me, and I would have no problem helping anybody one-on-one coming up with ways to help homeschool your kid, how to make it happen. You know, any kind of advice that I can give, hit me up at the Facebook page Raising Common Sense Anarchist, and I'll definitely get back to you. I have a Twitter feed too. I haven't used it in forever. I hardly ever use it, but hit me up at Twitter. I'm at Johnny Voluntary, J-O-N-N-Y Voluntary, and I'd be happy to help anybody with any additional questions.
Yes, definitely. I mean, homeschooling and unschooling can be a solitary and lonely thing, and so it's mm-hmm. vitally important that you connect with people that are doing it. You know, connect through Facebook, through, you know, there's Yahoo groups, there's, you know, just look in your area, you know, there's a lot of people. You know, when you start looking, you really realize how many people are doing it, and it should not be a lonely thing. You know, that's the problem. That's the other fallacy is, you know, people think, you know, we just throw our kids, you know, in the room, throw books at them and lock the door and that's homeschooling, right? You know, it's out being out and meeting other families and going to museums, going to trails, hiking and parks and, you know, just doing fun activities. And that's, you know, that's education right there, you know? So,
sure.
So don't go ahead.
There are two points that I do want to make real quick before we wrap this up, and this will be my final two points. Is one thing to consider is if your child has never been into public school, you can ignore this next part. But if your child has been in public school, even for 1 or 2 years, when you pull them out, you're going to have a transitional period called deschooling. And what deschooling is it refers to the transitional period from taking your child out of a heavily structured, heavily regimented learning institution, and you're putting them into the free world and saying, go, learn what you want, go do what you need to do, go learn, be free. And it is a bit of an adjustment period. And yeah, there are still days when my daughter does nothing but watch stupid Barbie cartoons on TV. And that's okay, that's what she needs to do to get used to it. This period of transition can take anywhere from 6 months to 2 years. So, you know, be patient. My daughter is still going through that a little bit. It's not as bad as it was before, but she's starting to understand that, okay, she has this freedom and not everything is regimented by a bell or by a timer. So she's getting used to that. You know, like I said, that's only really important if you've had a child in public school before and you're taking them out now. Any of you guys thoughts on that? On deschooling?
Yeah. I mean, get your kids out of gun-free zones. That's what I mean. No, I agree. I mean, yeah, that's what Amanda was talking about. She said there was this weird transition period when she got her kids out of schools, but she said her kids are acting so much better. There's so much just the family coherency is so much higher. And you know, the proof is in the pudding. When someone can come on and say that they're seeing positive results from this, it's very hard to disagree with. You know, and, you know, we can say what we want, that's not, you know, pure evidence or whatnot. There's not a controlled study or whatnot, but it's working for someone. Try it. If it doesn't work, put your kid back into the prison for their mind.
Yep. And yeah, that was the period she was talking about. It's called deschooling. It's that transitional period. It's very important that you remain patient during this time. Don't get frustrated if you see your kid just watching TV or, you know, just doing some bullshit all day when they could be learning. Leave them alone. They'll pick up the books. They will pick up their learning materials. They will pick up their notepad and pencil and write stories. They will do all this stuff. But you have to give them some time. Give them some time. Like I said, it could take up to 2 years. It could take as short as 3 months. You don't know. Last point I would like to get to, and this is a really important one. And as new homeschoolers, you're probably going to run into this a lot, and that's critical family and friends. On one hand, you would like to just tell them to kick rocks and be done with it. It'll leave you alone. But at the same time, these are your close friends and family that you deal with a lot, and they're going to have questions. family especially. Maybe your friends are good enough where they can say, ah, my weirdo homeschooling friend, and just leave it at that. But you're probably going to have family that thinks this is a terrible, terrible idea. They won't want to hear any of your evidence. They won't want to hear any of your studies. It's all feels, and it's what they think. And I just want you to be prepared that you are going to have family members that don't agree with this, and no amount of debating is going to convince them otherwise. You may have to tell them, like, listen, I love you, but we can't discuss this anymore. This is the way it is. You can either respect it or not.
Mm-hmm. Or you could just hit them with the simple fact that 100% of everyone that goes to high school dies. And, you know, if they're going to hit you with the feels train, you hit them right back, you know?
Yeah, exactly. So that's that. Just, you know, some things to be aware of if you do choose to homeschool, which I do hope you do. And if you have any questions or any concerns, you know, please get me at Twitter. Again, that's Jonny, Jonny Voluntary. Hit me up at Raising Common Sense Anarchist on Facebook. You know, hit me up at my other page too, the New Sons and Daughters of Liberty. Shoot me a question. I'll get back to you.
Okay. Well, all right. No, I'm just going to say, you know, on the idea of, you know, family disagreeing. Yeah, that is a very difficult part of it, but you know, it's something that we all have to you know, not only unschooling but even just voluntarism. You know, a lot of us come from status backgrounds, so yeah, you're gonna endure the wrath and scorn of people that have raised you, and interestingly enough, sometimes they feel personally offended if you unschool because they send you to the government school. So sometimes they take that as a personal offense at their own parenting method, you know?
Oh, sure.
And I have to clarify. No, I'm not faulting you. I'm just saying I don't choose to raise my kids that way. And maybe you know, I don't think you had malicious intent. You know, you probably did the best you can with what you knew, and that's it. You know, you weren't trying to indoctrinate me, right? You thought that was the best thing. You thought, you know, everybody sends a kid to public school, it must be good, so I'm gonna send my kid to public school.
I mean, we hear it all the time. I mean, how often do we hear, like, oh yeah, I went to public school and I turned out fine.
Yeah, exactly. You know? But yeah, we can go on and on. So we'll wrap it up. So thanks a lot, John, for coming on the show. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, anytime. I always have a blast with you guys. You guys are fun.
Yeah, the subject needs to be visited and revisited because, you know, as long as government school exists, we must continue to rail against it and remove your child as a... As Dave said, you know, you got to rob the state of your child's mind, one mind at a time. We're robbing the state, right? So, you know, hopefully we can make a dent.
That's the title of the show right there.
Excellent. Rob the state rob the state of your child.
That are our hot homeschooling moms. I'm really torn.
We're torn right between the two. All right.
I'm torn. I think the hot homeschooling moms is going to get more views, though. Click, so we might
bait,
go with that.
Clickbait, Jeremy. Come on. Think of the clickbait. All right. All right, so thank you very
much. I am above Austin Peterson tactics. Screw that.
He's running for president, bro.
That would be one of the aforementioned tactics I am above.
Oh, God. I'd rather Bernie get
so
in.
So anybody want to help us out, you can like, share, comment, subscribe to our channel. That's always going to help us get the word out, as well as supporting us on Bitcoin, PayPal. Oh, no, not PayPal. Sorry. Or Patreon. Bitcoin and Patreon. The links are below. So please help us out if you want to help us continue providing content. We love doing this. And, you know, if we get monetary support, that's just wonderful feedback for us. So thank you very much, everyone, for listening. This is the Seeds of Liberty podcast. You can all those links on theseedsofliberty.com. I should mention. So this is The Seeds of Liberty. Wishing everyone have a wonderful day. Take care.
Thank you, John.